Hello students, let us continue with the Riemann integration theory. So in last class we had done one criterion for integrability of a bounded function. So in today's lecture we will see another such criterion, similar criterion. So before that we need to do this theorem, Darboux theorem, which states as follows. If f is a bounded function on closed interval a b, then for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that UPF is strictly less than the upper integral plus epsilon, and the LPF is greater than lower integral minus epsilon for every partition p with norm p less than delta. Norm is the mesh of the partition, the length of the largest sub interval. Okay, so in the earlier theorem, this came as a part of the definition of infimum of all upper sums. This part came as definition of supremum of all lower sums. Okay, but here this theorem gives something extra, that not only this is true for one partition, it is true for every partition which satisfy norm less than some given delta which depends on epsilon. Okay, so we need to prove that. So this is the proof. First of all, we have the upper integral. It is by definition, it is the infimum of all upper sums, infimum of UPF such that P is a partition of AB. So we start with any given epsilon greater than 0. Start with an given epsilon greater than 0. Then by definition of infimum, there exists a partition P1, say x0, x1, x2 up to xp of AB such that UP1F is strictly less than upper integral plus epsilon by 2. This follows directly from the definition of infimum. Because no number greater than this upper integral can be a lower bound. Okay, so that means there exists a partition for which UP1F is strictly less than this. So now let P equal to Y0, Y1, Y2 up to Yn be a partition of AB, any partition we are considering. And then you consider Q equal to P union P1. It is the union of P and P1. Then what is Q? Q is a refinement of both P1 and P2. This also we had done earlier. So Q contains how many points more than P? Let us analyze that. So we have both P and P1, they are partitions. So X0 equal to A for P1, Y0 equal to A for P. Similarly, XP equal to B for P1 and YN equal to B for P, right? So for both the partition, the starting point and ending point are the same. P1 has how many points? P1, the partition P1 has got P plus 1 points. X0, X1 up to XP, that means P plus 1 points. And the partition P has got n plus 1 points. So out of these P plus 1 points, 2 points are in common with the points in P. That means at most P1 has P union P1 has at most P minus 1 points which are distinct, at most P minus 1 points which are distinct from the points in P, right? So this is what we'll observe here. Since x0, y0 equal, they are equal to A, and xp and yn are equal to B. So Q contains at most P minus 1 points more than P. Okay, it may happen that some points of P1 coincide with the points in P. Okay, but in the worst or in the most general case, the points are distinct. So at most, not more than P minus points will be distinct. More than the points in P. Okay, so this is the explanation that I have mentioned. P1 has P plus 1 points, and 2 points X0 and XP are identical with Y0 and Yn. Hence, Q has at most P plus 1 minus 2, that is p minus 1 points more than p, right? So we try to estimate this difference, uqf minus upf. So suppose we proceed inductively. Suppose q has only one point, say xr more than p, then this xr will lie between some value. For some s, we must have xr lying between ys minus 1 and ys, right? Because it's a partition, p is a partition. So xr, wherever it is, it will lie between these two. It will lie between these two because there is no repetition here. Any point xr inside that interval ab will lie between any two of this yi and yj. Okay, so for some s, we must have ys minus 1 less than xr less than ys. So let us explain this using this diagram. If we observe nicely this diagram, p equal to p is this partition y0, y1, y2, ys minus 1, ys up to ys plus 1 up to yn, and q contains one more point than p. So the points from y0 to ys minus 1, they are all similar, and xr is the extra point, and from ys to yn n, again the points are same. So what is capital MI? As per our earlier notation, capital MI is the supremum of fx in the interval yi minus 1 to yi for every I equal to 1 to up to sn. So between these two, ys minus 1 to xr, and between xr to ys, the supremum of the function may be different, right? So in the whole interval ys minus 1 to ys, in the whole interval ys minus 1 to ys, the supremum of f is ms, right? Ms. And in the interval ys minus 1 to xr, let that supremum be denoted by m ys minus 1 to xr. It is the supremum of f in this smaller interval, right? And another one, let us denote this. From xr to ys, the supremum is denoted by m xr to ys. Okay, that is the supremum of f in the interval, smaller interval this. Now the union of these two interval is this ys minus 1 to ys, and capital M is the supremum in the whole interval, in the larger interval, right? And this is the supremum, this is the supremum in this xr to ys, and this is the supremum in ys minus 1 to xr, right? So what is the relation between ms and ms ys minus 1 to xr and m xr to ys? They have got some relation, and that relation is at least one of them should be equal to capital Ms. At least one of them will be equal to capital Ms, right? Because this ys minus 1 to ys, it is the union of disjoint, not disjoint, it is the union of ys minus 1 to xr, closed interval, union with xr to ys, right? So the supremum of f in this whole interval will be equal to one of the suprema in each of this sub interval, right? At least one of them will be equal to the whole supremum. That is the point that we have to note. Either m ys minus 1 to xr is ms, or m xr to ys is capital ms. This is what we have to note. Hence, if you take the difference uqf minus upf, so you will see that everything corresponding to these portions, they cancel out. The sums corresponding to these portion, they cancel out. ys minus, all these portions, they cancel out. What is remaining is this portion. Only this portion is remaining. So what is that? It is m ys minus 1 to xr multiplied with xr minus ys minus 1 plus, so we are taking all upper sums, right? M x r to y s multiplied with the difference in that interval minus M s multiplied with the difference in the whole larger interval. So just we have split it. Instead of y s minus 1, we write it as y s minus x r plus x r minus y s minus 1. And then we can just group the terms together. So this will be less than or equal to this plus this. This is the triangle inequality. Mod of x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. And again, this is less than or equal to, instead of this quantity, we can substitute mu p. Instead of this quantity, not instead actually, this quantity is less than or equal to mu p. Mu p is the norm of the partition p, mesh of the partition p. Okay, so x r minus x y s minus 1 is a smaller subinterval of a subinterval of p, right? So the length of this subinterval will be obviously less than or equal to mu p. Length of this subinterval is also less than or equal to mu p. Okay, I think this should be xr. Please correct it. This should be xr. Ys mod of ys minus xr. Okay. Ys minus xr. Mod of this. Mod of ys minus xr. This quantity, it should be mod of ys minus xr. So please note this down. So in each case, these are less than or equal to mu p, the norm of the partition. So by 2, one of the terms, this must be 0. Right, and also since f is bounded, so there exists a positive real number k, such that mod of fx is less than or equal to k for every x inside ab. So the k is an upper bound of f. So we have this quantity is less than or equal to mod of this plus mod of this, which is less than or equal to, so these are least upper bounds, so they will be less than or equal to other upper bounds. So this is less than or equal to k plus k, that is twice k. And this quantity is also less than or equal to twice k, but one of them is equal to 0, so only one term will remain, and ultimately uqf minus upf can be written as less than or equal to twice k multiplied with norm of p, mu p. So this was the case when q has only one point more than p. So if q has at most p points more than p, then we can proceed inductively. We can consider each p points, p minus 1 point separately, and then proceed inductively to show that uqf minus upf is twice k multiplied with, so for each such point we will get a term like twice k into mu p. So there are p minus 1 more points, so we will get p minus 1 such terms. So it is twice k into p minus 1 multiplied with mu p. But as you know, the refinement decreases the lower sum. So UPF is greater than UQF. UPF is actually greater than or equal to UQF. So this modulus will evaluate to UPF minus UQF. So this is less than or equal to twice KP minus 1 into mu P. So UPF is less than or equal to UQF plus this quantity. Again, Q is also a refinement of P1, so refinement decreases the lower upper sum, So UQF is less than or equal to UP1F plus twice K into P minus 1 mu P. But what is UP1F? That was less than, strictly less than, UP1F was strictly less than the upper integral plus epsilon by 2. Okay, so we have UPF is less than upper integral plus epsilon by 2 plus some quantity, and we can control this quantity. How we can control? By choosing a partition P whose norm is less than epsilon by something, some quantity which cancels out. Okay, so if you just observe, we want another epsilon by 2 term here. So we are free to choose partitions as per our requirement. So mu p, if we choose the norm of the partition less than epsilon by 4 into k into p minus 1, so this quantity let us denote it by delta. Okay, so in that case, for every partition p with mu p less than delta, we have UPF is strictly less than integration a to b bar plus epsilon. Okay, so whatever partition you take with norm less than delta, this particular inequality will be always satisfied. So the result for LPF follows with similar arguments, but please observe that the delta for both will be different. When you prove it, for UPF it will be delta 1, for LPF it will be delta 2, but no problem, we can take the minimum of delta to be minimum of delta 1 and delta 2, and both will be satisfied by delta. Okay, so the common delta will work for both UPF and LPF. So important thing to observe here is that the definition of infimum gives existence of at least one partition P of AB with UPF less than integration A to B upper integral plus epsilon, but Darboux theorem gives the existence of infinitely many partitions satisfying this inequality, provided norm P is less than delta, which depends on epsilon. Okay, so here we have another criterion for integrability using this Darboux theorem. So let f from a to b be a bounded function, then f is integrable if for each epsilon greater than 0 there exists a delta greater than 0 such that UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon for every partition P with mu p less than delta. So in the last video, the same condition for integrability was there, but one thing was missing was that in that theorem we had found out one partition for which this happens. Here we have found out infinitely many partitions for which this happens. And so necessary part, let f be integrable, then this lower integral and upper integral are equal. So suppose they are equal to I. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given, then by Darboux theorem, just now that we have done, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that UPF is strictly less than upper integral plus epsilon by 2, because it is true for arbitrary epsilon, it is also true for epsilon by 2, so which is actually I plus epsilon by 2, and LPF is greater than lower integral minus epsilon by 2, so it is I minus epsilon by 2. So for every partition P with mu P less than delta. Hence, what is UPF minus LPF? Just subtract this inequalities. So I will get cancelled. So epsilon by 2 by epsilon by 2, this becomes epsilon. So UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon for every partition P with mu P less than delta. Conversely, for each delta greater than 0, for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a, for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta which satisfies that UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon for every partition P with mu P less than delta. So you start with one arbitrary epsilon, let epsilon greater than 0 be given, then by above hypothesis, whatever we have written, there exists a delta which satisfies this for every partition P with mu P less than delta. Now lower integral is what? It is the supremum of all lower sums, and hence for all those P that we have got with part with norm P less than delta, we have integration lower integral is greater than or equal to LPF because it is the supremum of all lower sums, and upper integral is the infimum of all upper sums, so upper integral is less than or equal to UPF. So lower integral minus upper integral minus lower integral that is greater than or equal to 0 because lower integral is always less than or equal to upper integral. So 0 less than or equal to this, less than or equal to UPF minus LPF, because of those two inequalities that we have just seen, these two inequalities, and then this is less than epsilon by the hypothesis, right? This is the less than epsilon by hypothesis. So ultimately we have shown that the whatever be epsilon, we can always make the difference between upper integral and lower integral less than epsilon. Okay, so but epsilon is an arbitrary quantity, so this has to be the quantity difference between upper and lower integral has to be zero. So that is f is integrable. So this was another criterion for integrability, using the Darboux theorem. So in the next video we will be doing some other important aspects of Riemann integration. We will show how continuous functions are on closed interval are Riemann integrable, monotone functions on closed intervals are Riemann integrable, and also we will also discuss the Riemann integrability using the Riemann sum approach, the approach used by Riemann. We will be discussing that also, and we will show that the approach by Darboux and approach by Riemann are equivalent. And so that we will be doing in the next video. Thank you.